kind of going to be one of the culminating sermons for our 10-year anniversary. We're going to go to 2 Kings chapter number 2, and prayerfully we'll be able to put a nice button on kind of what we've been talking about over the last several weeks here. All right, here we go. 2 Kings chapter number 2, verse number 1 is where we're going to start on this morning, and you can take a look at the screen here. I'm going to jump around a little bit in the interest of time. You can read the 15 verses in totality on your own, but let's start verse number one. Now, when the Lord was about to take Elijah, this is a story about Elijah, the prophet, and Elisha, his mentee, if you will. The Lord was getting ready to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind. Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elijah and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Drop down with me to verse number 6, and he says, "Then Elijah said to him, 'Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan.' But Elisha said, 'As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you.' So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went, stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle, rolled it up, and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, 'Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you.' Elisha said, 'Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit.'" Other versions say anointing. Other versions say power. Verse number 10, Elijah responded, and he said, "You have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I'm being taken from you, it will be granted. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended into a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha kept watching, crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, Elisha grasped his own clothes, tore them into pieces, picked up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him, and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him, struck the water, saying, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" When he struck the water was parted to the one side and to the other. Elisha went over, and the company of prophets who were at Jericho saw him at a distance and declared, "The spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha." And they came to him, bowed to the ground before him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to spend the topic, you know, our theme for this whole year so far has been moving forward. And I want to keep building a little bit on that theme, and certainly even opening it up a little bit in this moment. Move forward with the mantle. Move forward with the mantle. Bow your heads with me, Father, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our heart so we will not sin against you and sin your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest on me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. 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 Don't go without the mantle. If you don't tweet today, certainly feel free to do that. You should tweet that. Don't go without the mantle. Let's see how this opens up for us. Now, on this homecoming Sunday, as we are culminating a celebration of 10 years at the Way, I believe if we take a serious look at the world around us, we are living in perilous times. We're certainly living in complex and very difficult times. And certainly we find ourselves as a people, as a nation, as a church, at a crossroads. We know, many of you that have followed us for a while, know that we take seriously the realities of what's happening every day in our world, that we're not so disconnected from the world because we are followers of Jesus, that we aren't felt or feeling the challenges of every day. And this week has been increasingly agitational for many of us who continue to watch with horror all the many manifestations of state violence, of exclusion, of trouble. I got a call early this week, or last week actually, of a family from South Hayward. Their son has been in jail in Santa Rita for over 6 months on what many believe are trumped up charges. They think he's a part of some gang or something. And he died in jail in Santa Rita. And fascinating, I was sitting there talking with the family. They were telling me how there were so many other families. Most of these folks are Latino, monolingual speaking, some of them undocumented, so they're fearful of coming forward because they don't want to be targeted for demanding justice in their communities. I was very struck by another reading of events where I believe it was Bank of America or Citigroup, or somebody got fined like $700 million for engaging in illegal credit activities, pretty much continuing to steal all of our money. Somebody say amen. Amen. And folks, you know, I didn't hear a peep about that anywhere, but you burned down one little CVS and everybody gets all outraged. Somebody say amen, right? All kinds of things happening all over the place. And you know, this week about 1,000 of our revolutionary friends gathered in Cleveland for a movement meeting with all these young folk, and we sent a few of our folk out there, and Sandra Bland got eulogized yesterday, and this is on and on and on and on and on. And I was at a meeting, and someone asked me, you know, Pastor Mike, what is the role of the church and the people of God in these times? And I began to think a little bit about that because, you know, I always have a lot of ideas about these kinds of things, but I thought uniquely about what could we, as we're celebrating and moving forward in a way, how can we renew and recommit ourselves to the unique calling of God's people in the world? Because make no mistake about it, there's all kinds of callings that people will embrace. All kinds of responses to injustice, all kinds of responses to sin, all kinds of responses to salvation, to faith, all kinds of ways that people will respond to all of these kind of realities, what some would call the ultimate concern of truth. But I believe, and I continue to believe, that there is a unique way that the church is called to respond. You and I, followers of Jesus, you and I who meet in a place like this, not because we don't have better things to do, but we meet here because we realize that there's some kind of function and purpose behind us being together. To remind ourselves that even though the world is falling down around us, God is still building a kingdom. A kingdom that cannot be destroyed by human efforts, human evil, that the kingdom of God continues to be built, and we are co-builders with God. Yeah. Regardless of your age, my brothers and sisters, I want you to always remember that you are building the kingdom of God. Yes. And you must build the kingdom of God no matter where you are, no matter who you're around, no matter who is leading you. My commission to you today is keep building this kingdom. This is part and parcel of what I believe our response has to be, is that even though the world is kind of having all of this challenge, how many of you know that the work that God is doing is consistently being done? Amen. Even through all the hardships and the pain. Now that ought to be some good news for some of us, because just because you're having a hard time don't mean God takes a break. Clutch your name to somebody. God is not taking a break because you're having a hard time. And I don't know, maybe none of y'all have hard times, amen. But I'm glad that even in my unfaithfulness, God remains faithful. Amen.
Even in my places of doubt, God keeps believing in me. Even in my space of disobedience, God continues to be faithful to what God saw in me and us before we started to take a look at what God was working on. The kingdom of God, it is always at work. And part of what I believe is we must always show up to the Word of God, with the Word of God, filled with the hope of God. I love Alvin Aaron. He's a good friend of mine. We work in this, some of this PICO work together. He says like this, if you show up with hope, people will give you their hopelessness. And ain't that a great, great commitment for the people of God? That wherever I go, I'm bringing some hope. And I'm not talking about no hope that is detached from the concreteness of the possibility of transformation and change. I'm talking about the hope that is at work even right now in my life, in the life of the church, in the life of God's work in the world. Give your neighbor a high five and tell them, show up with hope, show up with hope, show up with hope. This then becomes a critical way for you and I to understand this idea of the mantle. Because my brothers and sisters, always remember that this mantle, quote unquote, that we're talking about in this text, is grounded in this idea that prophets, particularly those folks who are uniquely called out to do the work of God, are always given some kind of tools so they can do the work of God most powerfully. The mantle, it represents the legacy of those that came before you. It reminds you that you did not get here on your own strength. And the work that you're going to do continuously is not going to happen on your own strength. The mantle connects you to a story and an assignment, a project that has predated you and will continue to go on even after you kind of mosey off the scene. Don't go without this mantle, because this mantle represents, as it did with the prophets, the concrete presence of God. And my brothers and sisters, on this 10-year anniversary, I want you and I to appreciate that we as a church, as followers of Jesus, we have inherited a mantle. A mantle of power, a mantle of authority, a mantle of purpose, a mantle of destiny. And part of our job is to not go without this mantle. Yeah. Now be clear, there is always a mantle you are wearing.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. None of us are showing up mantle-less. None of us are showing up without some kind of a way of seeing the world, understanding the world, some kind of assignment, some kind of trajectory. And this mantle that has been given to you and I, particularly we who want to move through a prophetic space and lens, we must appreciate that God has endowed us with this mantle. And particularly in the Old Testament, this mantle is synonymous when you move over to the New Testament with this idea of the Holy Spirit, the power of God. And I want you to appreciate that just like the mantle in the story read today, Elijah had this mantle, and all prophets mostly, they wore this mantle, and it served two functions. There was a practical function and a spiritual function. The practical function, imagine it being a coat, some kind of unique kind of outer garment that helped keep them warm, helped them when they were needed to do prayer, help them engage in certain kinds of distinctive identification, a practical purpose. The mantle helped set them apart. So people would see them and be like, oh, you must be a part of that company of prophets. Because everybody wore the same kind of mantle. But there was also a very spiritual function of the mantle. It meant that you were always reminded that there was a unique presence of God's Spirit at work in your life. It was also there to help you do some miracles, do some things that other folks would see impossible. So I want you to think about this for a second. This mantle, it is indicative of a practical and a spiritual purpose. And I believe that our role as prophets, prophetesses, as people who are the people of God in this moment, we are to use this mantle, this unique calling of God, for both practical and supernatural purposes. It is not just for us to walk around here just trying to save the world and we're using the mantle, whatever it is, to improve our lives in a practical sense. Nor is it just for us to use the mantle when we're in church together, engaging in our very similar practices and all of our instances of Christianese. Somebody say amen, right? That this mantle has both a practical purpose in the world, but also a supernatural purpose in the world. And God is calling for us to be people who are able to fuse the two. What does it mean for you and I to embrace that it is not an either or, it is a both and? Your calling and your unique gifting is intended to bless both, I said it a few weeks ago, the body and the soul, the world and the kingdom. And everywhere you go, you have to appreciate that this is the function of the mantle. And if you don't have this mantle, you can easily find your way being led towards one direction or the other. But I will submit to you that God wants to hold us steady and focused in the tension of both. Because how many of you know if you're going to work in both of those callings, there's going to be some tension. There'll be tension inside of us. Because some of the stuff that we're working on is a little bit of a piece of work. Dare I say, ourselves, we a piece of work. You ought to give me a quick high five and just remind me that. We're a piece of work. Absolutely. And this mantle is necessary because it helps you and I to navigate the pieces of work that is us or our communities or our circumstances or our situations around us. Now, part of what I want you and I to appreciate is the way that this mantle then is maximized. I'll give you a few ideas and then we'll try to spend a few moments responding to this. Is if you and I are going to use this mantle, take this mantle, not go without this mantle, one of the first things that we have to remember is we must stay connected and grow. Everybody say, stay connected and grow.
Stay connected and grow.
Now, appreciate that staying connected and growing is a reminder to us that we must live in community. You and I, particularly when we take a look at this story, Elijah and Elisha are part of a company of prophets, meaning that the prophets ran with other prophets. They did not hang out with folk who were not committed to the call of their lives. And it is important for you and I to appreciate that you can only be as good and effective as those folk who are around you helping to catapult you into your best destiny and self. Hello. Encapsulated by this idea when I was in seminary, one of the things that, and it's still going to happen, don't know exactly when, but I wanted to start a school of the prophets, where we can just churn out people who are just committed to prophetic living. And then I started thinking, well, how about that just be the whole church? Amen. We'll all just be prophets. I don't want to be some prophets. Like, I don't know if that's a prophet. That's not kind of spooky. Amen. I'm just trying to be a Christian, so I said, God bless you. Amen. That's coming too. Somebody shout hallelujah. But this idea, right, that the prophets are always hanging out with the prophets. Jesus says it like this in the scripture. He says that you must be connected to me. Abide in me. And I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. And our church ministry has always had this idea, right, that you and I are connected to God and one another. And this idea that I cannot thrive, I cannot grow if I'm not connected first to God and then to the people of God. Hello. That it matters who you are connected to. It matters who you are around. It matters who is on your favorite list in your phone book. You know, the list that the first, you can learn a lot about somebody by the first 10 people that they put in their favorite list. Or if you go to most recently called in the names that keep popping up. Amen. I don't know how many folks want to share your list. But we can learn a lot about the people we are connected to. You can learn a lot about the places you hang out in.
All right.
You can learn a lot about the things that you are connected to. And I want to ask you and I to wrestle with this idea that our people, our places, and the things that we're connected to matter. You are naturally talented and gifted, make no mistake about it. I mean, you could not have graduated from that science engineering department with honors, and now you're a premier engineer in a big science tech company. You couldn't have did that if you didn't have no talent. If you didn't have no gift and have no skill, you couldn't be the teacher of the year. You couldn't be the academic of your department, the entertainer, the justice advocate. You couldn't be all those things if you didn't have talents and gifts. But how can we know that there's more that God wants from us?
Yes, sir.
Than just for us to excel in our given field? God wants you to be a prophet. A bold proclaimer of what God is doing. There's this quote that I have. It's from A.W. Tozer. And he says that they were prophets, not scribes. For the scribe tells us what they read, but the prophet tells us what they see. And how many of you know that you can do well by just kind of telling what you have read? There's a whole lot of folk who can master knowledge, but how many of us have the ability through the power that even though things are looking all bad and mad and stressed and tore up, there's something inside of me that has been placed there by God that gives me the ability to see what others can't see. Yes. And to be able to proclaim it with boldness. How does that look? Well, that looks like some folk you're going to meet and you're going to run into that cannot see themselves in the image of God. Because life has beat them up so bad.
Yeah.
There are going to be circumstances that are looking like they're totally falling apart. There are going to be situations in our own lives that are going to continue to feel like they are far from God's purposes.
Yeah.
And God's going to need each and every one of us, no matter where we are, to be able to be those bold proclaimers of what God sees. How many of you know what God sees and what we see are often two different things? And if you and I are going to grow, we must stay connected to those folks who have to be able to see what we can't see. Give me a high five and tell them, connect and grow, connect and grow, connect and grow, connect and grow. The second thing that you and I are going to have to appreciate is that if we're going to carry this mantle, we must, listen, this is going to be a hard one for some of us, be willing to pick up the mantle, but put down some other things. Everybody say, pick it up?
Pick it up.
Somebody else say, put it down. Elisha, he asked Elijah for a double portion of this anointing, of this mantle, of this spirit. And it's so interesting that as Elijah is being taken away into the glory of God, that Elisha's response was not only to cry out, but to tear his own mantle and clothes apart so he can have room to put on this new mantle. And some of us,
Lord help me today,
are trying to put the double portion mantle on top of the mantle we already got.
How many of you know that's not going to fit right? It definitely ain't going to look right. And it sure enough ain't going to work. Jesus said it like this. He said that you cannot pour new wine into old wineskins. This is why when Jesus comes into our lives, he comes to make us brand new. He don't make you forget the life you used to live, but he certainly wants you to appreciate that there's something new about this trajectory that you're on. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. Old things have passed away and all things have become new. And part of us picking up this mantle means that we have to be willing to let go of some other things.
All right.
And that's hard if we don't keep it real. Because we like what we like. Somebody say amen. Our tastes have become built around certain kinds of things. Somebody say amen. And if we're not careful, we can let our tastes and preferences block us from the double portion that God wants to give us. Our tastes, our preferences, things that we just got so used to, things we thought we could never live without. And it can become so deceptive, listen to me, that we can begin to ask God for a double portion of everything except his spirit. Everything except this mantle. So what are you asking God to do? I'm asking God to double my money. Ask God to double my honey. Has God to do my power, my career? Hello, somebody. We have not even got to, Lord, double your anointing and impact and power in my life. That is so far beyond our list.
Yes, sir.
Because we have become preoccupied with what we already have versus what God wants to give us. And my brothers and sisters, this is the moment in time where you and I must begin to ask God, what is it you want me to have so I can do what you want me to do? I believe that the world has challenges. I believe that my communities are in places of hurt and pain. I believe that even in my own walk and in my own going to stop all this violence, but we got the mantle of God. They think it's impossible we're going to defeat these unjust systems. We got the mantle of God. It's impossible you get that promotion, be positioned to be a better and powerful influencer. But guess what? You have the mantle of God. And the question is, what will you do with your mantle? You try to use the mantle just to become more popular, more rich, more of your own kingdom, or you take this mantle and say, the people I'm working for are working on a kingdom not made with wood and steel, a kingdom that cannot be built only by human hands, but it is a kingdom that is without end. Don't go without the mantle. Wherever you find yourself, take this mantle with you and wear it like a badge of honor. God has given you an identity that is better than your racial identity, your national identity, your sexual identity, your intellectual identity, your favorite, whatever it is. God has given you a mantle, and it is called His child, His prophet, His proclaimer. Take this mantle and let's press forward. Let's do some more 10 years of ministry. Let's do some more work. Let's build up some more. Stand with me.